would welcome me. I was lost, but he brought me to know his love for me. Know his love for me. The sun sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child. Jesus died for me. Yes, he died for me. Whom the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. I'm a child of God. Yes, I am. In my Father's house, there's a
died for our sins, God. You've made us a new creation, Father. We stand on that truth this morning. We stand on that truth this morning, God. We just thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. Father, you've paid a price. You've made a way for us, Lord. You've paid a price and you've made a way for us, Lord. And we just thank you, God. We thank you, Jesus, that we are justified because of what you've done on the cross, God. You've made us new, Jesus. And we just stand in that truth. We stand in the authority of Jesus Christ. We stand filled with the power of the Holy Spirit. The same Spirit that raised you from the grave, Jesus, is now living within us, Lord. You are for us. Who can be against us, God? We just thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus.
Mountains are still being moved. Strongholds are still being loose. God, we believe. Yes, we can see. The wonders are still what you do. Bodies are still being raised. Giants are still being slain. God, we believe. Yes, we can see. Wonders are still what you do. We are here for you. Come and do what you do. We are here for you. Come and do what you do. Set our hearts on you. Come and do.
We are here.
this is that
hope. Right now,
this is hope.
I think we can all agree that the move of God right now is not going to look like anything that's ever looked like before. Some of us have lived through some powerful moves of God. I certainly have, and many of you have. And I understand the Bible says, call for the sick and let the elders lay hands on them and anoint them with oil. And I also know it says that we're to lay hands one for another, but I also understand we're in a time where you can't even visit the hospital. Can't even go with your own husband or your own wife. I know my mother had to have a surgery during COVID-19, and her husband, my father, could not even be there with her. These are strange times, strange for us, but not for God, because before the Bible ever says anything about laying hands on the sick, the Bible says he sent forth his word and healed them. Hallelujah. So I want to just encourage you today that, yeah, we can't right now have you come here and lay hands on you and impart or anoint with oil or pray the prayer of faith, but the power of God in his word, he sends forth his word. Somebody could be healed right now. You can be healed watching online. You can be healed in this room right now because his word is still quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, and it's still going forth in power, and it's going forth with healing. So this is a move for somebody. You can still be healed. Yeah, I can't lay my hands on you. Don't call the pastor or the elder right now to do that. We pray and we send forth and we stand upon the word of God. His word can go forth. You know, there was a situation in the New Testament where the rich man came to Jesus and he said, my servant is sick and I need you to come quickly and lay your hand on him and heal him. He didn't say that. He said, I want you to heal him. He needs to be healed. And he thought he was going to have to come and, And he said, no, you don't have to come to my house, Jesus. I know you're busy. You don't even have to come. And the faith of this man to say to Jesus, if you'll just speak a word, I know my servant will be healed. Hallelujah. We're in a season like that right now. If you just speak a word, Jesus, because the word spoken out of your mouth has power and healing and deliverance in it. So this is a move we're in. It's uncomfortable. It's different. We have to keep distance from one another, but we are not distanced with God. His word is still yes and amen. More than ever, his word has the power to heal. He sent his word. He's sending a word right now for somebody that's going to heal you, that's going to break open peace in your life. It's going to open your mind. This clarity is coming. The pain is going. This is the move we're in. Let's get in this move and let's understand God is not, his hand is not shortened, his hand, he is not hindered in any way by what's going on in the land and in the world with this virus. God is still moving forward. The church is still advancing. His word is still powerful in your life. I can't come. Nobody can come and lay their hand on you, but the hand of God is mighty upon your life right now. He's holding you, as a matter of fact, in the palm of his hand. His word is going forth in a way I believe that it never has before, because these other means and methods we can't practice right now. His word is powerful, my friend, powerful to heal you, powerful to bring forgiveness of sin as you confess to him, powerful to bring peace and joy. So, Father, we embrace the move. It's uncomfortable and it's different. And as I preached a few months ago, it's inconvenient. Living the Christian faith is so inconvenient now, but Father, the dividends are still powerful. The benefits of serving you, there's still nothing that compares. So no, I know I can't go to somebody's house. I can't go to somebody's hospital room. Neither can you. But the word, speak the word, and the word will go forth in power and in healing, just as God has promised, just as his word is still yes, it's true, yes and amen, yesterday, today, and forever. The word of God will stand forever. Stand upon that word. Speak that word. You've got co-workers, friends, relatives, family members that need a healing, that need a touch from God, that need a visitation from God. Send forth the word through prayer to where they are. Holy Spirit, send forth the Spirit of God as Ezekiel was told to do with the dry bones. Speak forth the word and command bones to live and bodies to be healed and lives to be transformed. Get the word of God in your mouth, in your heart, in your lips as never before. And faith will be released every time you speak it, every time you pray it, every time you declare it. Faith will be released. Hallelujah. Because it was the faith of that rich man, it was his faith in the word of Jesus that brought healing to that servant when Jesus spoke the word. So this is the move, Lord. We are not waiting for this season to pass. We're not just kind of, you know, going through the motions and God is sort of in pandemic mode. No, you're not, Father. You are moving. Your spirit is moving across the earth and around the land, Father. And we thank you for that move. And we embrace it, Lord, because we're here for you today. We are here for you. Yes, come and move, Lord. Do what only you can do. Set our hearts. We're here for you, Lord.
Come and do what you do. Set our hearts.
Oh, saciamos sed, tu palabra es mi alimento de mí.
Yeah. Hallelujah.
If we're truly amazed at his love, we've got to just say something, don't we? We got to open up our mouth and thank him. Well, last week, God gave me a word that said he'll cause you to be occupied with gladness of heart. And if we're truly thankful, we'll be occupied, not occupied by COVID-19, not occupied by any other voices, all the other talking heads, all the other opinions, all the other posts and Twitters and hashtags. We'll be occupied with gladness of heart because we are thankful for the love of God. How far, how wide, how deep, it cannot be measured. And I don't know about you, I'm not just dabbling in it. I'm not just splashing in it. I'm just swimming in the love of God today. Thank you, Lord, for that love that's amazing. And we acknowledge that. We praise you for it. We make expression, God, as we continue to live life on the edge, knowing we're about to fall over into something supernatural very soon. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. We worship you today. We worship you. We worship you. God bless you. If you're in this room, you can be seated. If you're at home and you were standing with us, I hope you were. You can be seated now if you'd like to. Thank you, worship team. Just thought we ought to hear a little different perspective. I'm not saying I personally endorse, I don't even know who that is, but it so moved me what he said that just stirred my faith. God is still God, and he is still moving. And God bless this man for stepping out. I know I've been saying, and it reminded me again, there's a fine line during this pandemic between faith and foolishness, especially in the eyes of the world. And there are many that live right around here that think every one of you are foolish today for doing this. But we know our God is bigger. Our God has covered us. The blood of Jesus has covered us and is keeping us. And even for those that tested positive, that came through, or they're coming through to the other side, whole and well again. And we thank God for it. So anyway, God bless you. I just thought that would just, you know, just inspire you as it did me when I saw it. Our ushers are ready. We're going to worship God with our tithe. If you're in this room, if you're online, this is a great opportunity for you to pause, grab your device. With a couple of clicks, you can pay your tithe and be faithful. But God bless you right now in the building, in this point in the service, as we pay our tithe. The ushers are coming. You don't have to get out of your seat. Open heaven, you pour out blessing, you pour out provision, you pour out healing, you pour out grace, you pour out mercy, you pour out direction, peace, joy. Thank you for an open window over our lives as we walk in the tithe in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let me mention a couple of things. This is a significant day because it's the last Sunday for a while. We don't know how long. That we will have 10:30 service once on a Sunday. We're going to move to two services to give you the opportunity to be even more spaced out, and we don't want anybody to be uncomfortable by coming into this building and worshiping God. That would be an 11 a.m. service time for you that are watching online. We will only stream our service live at 11 a.m. starting next Sunday. We'll be in this building 9 a.m. There will also only be nursery, preschool, kids church at 11 a.m. Nursery, preschool, and kids church will only happen at 11 a.m. starting next Sunday. So we want you to be mindful of that and help us spread the word. I mean, help us tell anybody and everybody you know that comes to Acts 2. Tell somebody you don't know. We're in the process of changing, getting some little invitational, you know, some printing changed, and even our main church sign, you know, is going to be changed to reflect that we're worshiping on site at 9 and 11, and we're worshiping online at 11 every Sunday, starting next Sunday. Some of you got an urgent notice concerning our church phones. Our main church phone number, unfortunately, is down, has been down since Friday. Something happened in the power in this building. We don't even know what. And it kind of fried a phone system that is about 20 years old. We've always had it repaired. It can no longer be repaired. So we've had to order new equipment. We've got to wait for new equipment to arrive. We will notify you as best we can when our main church phone line, that's the 798-6995, some of you use that, is back in service. In the meantime, you know, you can always reach out via text. You can reach out via email. We are constantly, even myself, monitoring our texts and our email. You can reach out through our main text number, 561-232-3992, which we use for many things in ministry here, and we will respond to you, or you can send an email to info at. I also monitor that email, and I'll make sure to respond to you. But hopefully by midweek, Wednesday we hope, Thursday at the latest, the new phone system will be installed and we'll be back connected in that way. But thank God, that's a time I thank God for internet connection, because it was unaffected by whatever happened. Now, we're going to have communion today together. I'm going to give you some instruction in just a little bit. We're going to share communion as our closing time of just prayer and worship after the service, and it'll be we'll give you clear instruction. If you're online, we want you to have communion with us. You have time to grab a little juice, a little wafer, break off a cracker, a piece of bread, whatever you have there. We're going to pray over it. It's going to be consecrated unto the Lord as the body and blood of Christ in just a few moments, as we lift it up and pray over it together. But begin to prepare yourself now, and then after the sermon today, we're going to receive communion together and have just a little time of worship around the elements, and we're going to serve you that are in the room. You will not have to even get out of in the room. You will not have your seat to do that. All right, that's all that I think I need to talk about. I want to ask you to stand for those of you that want to bring your offerings. We are allowing you to do that. Put your mask on, of course, when you're moving around here in the building. And we're going to stand. Father, thank you for the opportunity to give. Thank you for what the offering means, Lord. We've got partners around the world that need to be strengthened, Lord. One of our missionaries contacting me just yesterday. They need some help. They need a special offering. They're struggling right now. Father, we thank you. I thank you for a church that gives offerings, whether they give online, they give if they're in this room, so that our missionaries and our missions partners and our outreach partners can continue to do what you've called them to do. And we thank you for the promise, your favor resting mightily upon us, and you'll bless and cause to come back to us multiplied. The way that we give is the way you're going to give back to us, Father. And we thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you if you're in this room and you're bringing your offerings.
Many of you know that this is a very special time for our pastors and our spiritual leaders. They are celebrating their birthdays. And the Lord is blessed where their birthdays are within 1 week. Within 1 week, so we get to congratulate them and wish them happy birthday at the same time. But let's just take a minute to look at this special presentation. God bless you.
Happy birthday, Pastor Kevin and Pastor Christy. We love you.
Hope you have an amazingly blessed year.
Happy birthday, Pastor Calvin and Christy, and have a beautiful day, and enjoy with your family, and with your granddaughter, and with everybody. And we love you very much. We love you. Bye-bye.
Happy birthday, Pastor Calvin and Pastor Christy. God bless you all.
We love you.
Bye.
Felicidades.
Felicidades. Bye-bye.
Happy birthday, Pastor Christy and Pastor Calvin. Just want to thank you guys for everything that you do. You feed us spiritually every week, and more than that, you guys are a great example, and I appreciate and I value having you guys in my walk. Enjoy your day.
Happy birthday to you, Pastor Calvin and Pastor Christy. I pray for heaven blessings that you do not have to receive. May God continue to keep you both. Enjoy your day.
Happy birthday, pastors. We love you and we're praying blessings over you.
Hi,
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, beloved pastors. Happy birthday to you.
Bye bye.
Bye bye.
Happy birthday.
Thank you so much, everybody. I won't say where we're at, but I'm still young. I'm still young. We are still young, my wife especially. But I know we're ready to receive the word, and like I said, we're going to receive the Lord's table together after the sermon today. Oh, I'm up here. I don't have to have that. Excuse me. I look like a bandit or something speaking to you. Pastor Jamil is coming. He's going to bring the word of the Lord to us. And he has a very special surprise as he comes down the aisle over here.
We got you.
Lucky.
Hello. This is Emilia Joy Hernandez, and this is my wife, in case you didn't remember. But Catherine. This is Catherine, and Emilia is 5 months, going on 6 months in August the 15th. So she is a handful. She is beautiful. Just right before she got on the way over here, she literally, she had an accident, and her clothes are filled with a present of accident stuff. But I wanted to present her to my church family. This is her. I don't know if y'all can go all the way over there, can see her. But But from us, Pastor Calvin, Pastor Christy, happy birthday. Happy birthday, and we pray that you are blessed, and we're grateful for your ministry to us, and we're grateful to be a part of the team. So, you gonna say something? You gonna say something? No, nothing? Okay, all right. All right, well, thank you guys. This is Amelia. This is my wife. We haven't met her yet. We are blessed, and thank you for your prayers, really. Thank you for your prayers, and thank you for just being another support system for us. So thank you, guys. Okay, my love. So, yes. Well, hello. It's all good. It's all good. It's all good. Yeah. I'll wait. So she goes. Yeah. Okay. So now that she's gone, I'm just playing. Again, like always, it's an honor and a privilege to be here with you to preach the Word of God. I never take that for granted, and honestly, just gathering together, we should never take that for granted, not more than ever, especially with what's going on in this country. So again, what a blessing and a privilege it is to just to be here together with you. So today we're going to be spending some time in Psalm 119 and talking about the Word of God, and specifically talking about the love of the Word of God. And essentially the love for truth, the love for the truth, the truth that surpasses all truth. Right now in America, there is a lot of talk of subjective truth. There is a lot of talk of there is no real truth. There is no objective truth. Truth, you just need to speak your truth. You just need to speak what's right to you. And as long as you're free to speak your truth, then we are good. And that puts, you know, to the side the exclusivity of Christianity, the exclusivity of salvation through Jesus Christ alone, through his grace and through his atonement and through what he has done, and the world sees it as like, oh, are you kidding me? How can that be? How can you say that your truth is the truth and all these other truths are not the truth? And we live in an age where it's like that. And let me be honest with you guys. With so much misinformation being so easily spread, it's hard for me to go on a site like Facebook and believe anything that's on there. Believe anything, because it's so easy to just make up things. I, with my limited knowledge of Photoshop, and I am not a graphic designer, that is not what I do, I would be able to create something in Photoshop, post it on Facebook, and if it goes viral or whatever, people will think that it's true, simply because I'm stating something that agrees with somebody else's bias. And what happens on Facebook is it's just this machine that confirms our own bias. And what happens is, for example, if Facebook found out, which they're very good at finding things like this out, if they found out that I love blue chairs, what am I going to have on my feed? Blue chairs everywhere, and how terrible red chairs are. And if they find out that I'm a Christian, they'll say, hey, get yourself a blue chair. It'll make you closer to God if you pray on this chair, right? So there's all these kinds of things and misinformation. And it might be something as like just simple and maybe nothing as harmful as it's a picture of Robert De Niro with a quote that says, time is money. And I look at stuff like that, I'm like, did that come from Robert De Niro? Did that really, why, what is this relation? Or it could be something harmful like, for example, President Trump holding up the Bible, and right next to him is a picture of Hitler holding up the Bible. If you do some research there, you find that that photo is actually photoshopped. And I know many of us have seen that. That actual photo was photoshopped. The original photo is Hitler just holding up his hand in that Nazi fashion, just holding up his hand, and someone photoshopped the Bible into his hand, right? And that got crazy viral, that people were comparing Trump to Hitler because of that. Or maybe it's something concerning gun violence or black-on-black crime or police violence. And I saw this one graphic that gave some statistics. And at the very end of it, it says source, Wikipedia. And if you know anything about Wikipedia, you know that anybody and everybody can create an account and just put anything on there. When in fact that those statistics, when you compare them to the FBI site or other national other national sources, you'll find that they were grossly exaggerated. So this is we have to be careful. We have to be careful with the kind of information that we are spreading around and information that we are seeing as truth just because it agrees with our bias and it agrees with our way of life and our way of thinking. And this is why the Bible is so important. Because the Bible does not care about your bias, does not care about your way of thinking. The Bible itself says that it is a double-edged sword that will cut right through all the junk, right through all the junk. The Bible says that it is a mirror. It is a mirror that if you were to look at this, it is a reflection of yourself. And James says that if you read this and don't do what it says, you're like a man who looks in a mirror and forgets what he looks like. So he compares the Bible to the mirror. We are looking at a reflection of ourselves. The fruit of the Spirit, that's who I really am. The way Jesus walked, that's who I really am. The way God shows love and mercy, that's what I am capable of because of the Holy Spirit and because of what Jesus has done on the cross. So when we're talking about truth and misinformation or truth and just information, today's message is about how the real truth is the truth that we should be pushing. The real truth is the truth that we should be giving and making go viral with everybody else. The real truth is the focus, because when we are here, when our face, oh man, I'm about to make a real corny, I guess it's a dad joke now. When our face is not in Facebook, but when our face is in the book, right? There you go. God will give us, someone got it out there. God will give us wisdom and understanding to cut through all the stuff. Because right now, there is so much misinformation. And what the enemy wants to do is he wants to distract us. He wants us to focus on these earthly problems and forget about how great God is. He wants us to focus on how terrible this world is. He wants us to focus on him. And I've met with Christians who all they focus on is just the attack of the enemy. What all they focus on is the enemy himself. They read the word to learn about the enemy. But it's about Jesus. It's about God. We should be reading the word to learn about the Father, the one who created everything, the all-powerful one, the all-knowing one. And in doing so, we have power over the enemy. Over the enemy. Obviously, God's going to give us wisdom concerning the tactics of the enemy. But our focus should not be the work of the enemy. Our focus should be the work of the cross and what Jesus has done on the cross. And what that means for our lives, and what that means for our families, and what that means for this nation, and what that means for the world. So here in Psalm 119, we find somebody who is utterly in love with the Word of God. And I read through Psalm, don't worry, we're not going to go through the entire Psalm, it's very long. But we are going to go through some sections and we are going to see how David here, he desires the Word of God more than anything else. And let's just start with verse 1. Blessed are they whose ways are blameless, who walk according to the law of the Lord. Blessed are they who keep his statutes and seek him with all their heart. I just want to pause there. And this should go without saying, but our relationship with God, our walk with God, is with everything that we have. And I want to challenge you. I want to challenge you. And when we talk about this a lot, and forgive me if I'm a broken record, but coming to church once a week is not seeking after God with all my heart. Coming to church to learn from the pastor is not seeking after God with all my heart. If we're talking about seeking after God with all my heart, and he goes on to speak about some of these things, we're talking about going home and meditating on the Word of God. You wrestling with the Word of God. You going into your prayer closet one-on-one with God and the Word of God. And let me say this here, too, and for some of us online as well. There are people who have been coming to church for a very long time and still don't know how to read the Word of God on their own. Is that our fault? Is that our responsibility for you to just read the Word? And there are ways. Maybe you're not a great reader. Okay, listen to the Word of God. Dwell Bible app, amazing, right? Even the free Bible app, you can listen to it like that. Let's say you want to listen to the Word of God with a real cool hip-hop beat in the background. I got you. It's called Streetlights Bible App. It's a real thing, and it's free, and it's the Word of God. And it's the Word of God. Right now, with today's technology, there is no excuse. No excuse to not feed yourself in the Word of God. And today's focus is the Word of God. Today's focus is because there is no supplement for it. There is no supplement for your interaction with the Word of God. While I'm standing up here preaching to you, you are getting a filtered through Jamil's perspective Word of God. But God wants to speak to you directly through his Word. He wants to touch your heart. He wants you to realize the power and the depth and the greatness of his love because you experienced it reading it yourself. He wants you to see the greatness and the power and exactly what Jesus did on the cross because you experienced it, not because I said a few fancy words up here, but for you to get it. And that takes seeking God with all of our heart. And guys, 2020 has shown us what have we else to lose. I saw some crazy article talking about the government finding something about UFOs and releasing, like August, what are you going to bring to us? What is happening? What is happening with all this stuff? So, verse 3, the people who seek God with all their heart. They do nothing wrong. They walk in his ways. You have laid down precepts that are to be fully obeyed. Oh, that my ways were steadfast in obeying your decrees. Then I would not be put to shame when I consider all your commands. I will praise you with an upright heart as I learn your righteous laws. I will obey your decrees. Do not utterly forsake me. How can a young person keep his way pure? By living according to your word. And again, I seek you with all my heart. Do not let me stray from your commands. If we look at verse 10. I seek you with all my heart. Do not let me stray from your commands. God's hand is what will keep you and strengthen you on this path of righteousness. God's hand is what will keep you and strengthen you as you seek him with all your heart. There is no separation between your efforts and God's. Because the reality is that our efforts are futile. Our efforts will last about 30 minutes a week. Our efforts will last for a very short period of time, but through the power of the Holy Spirit. And believe me, God wants you to do this more than you want to do it. So if it's a question of whether or not God is going to empower you to read through the Word of God, to learn through the Word of God, to fall in love with the Word of God, and to do the Word of God, then that is not even a question, because God is calling you to do that, and He empowers you to do it through the Holy Spirit. Let me remind you, the Holy Spirit was not with everybody before Jesus, but Jesus came and He said, I have to go so that the Holy Spirit can come. And before the Spirit of God, and we're going to read about this later, the Spirit of God was in this holy place where only one high priest could go once a year. But now, because of the coming of the Holy Spirit and the Pentecost, the Holy Spirit is now available to all who believe in Jesus. And now it's not just a temple with a holy place and a most holy place that is divided by a curtain where the Holy Spirit, where the Spirit of God stayed, and only one person can enter. Now you are the temple. You are the holy place in which the Holy Spirit dwells and lives. So much so that in Galatians chapter 5, it says that there's a war going on inside of you. There's a war going on between your flesh and your spirit, and your flesh desires everything opposite of the spirit, and the spirit desires everything opposite of the flesh, and they are constantly at war. But because of the power of the Holy Spirit and the freedom that God has given us, it says in the beginning of Galatians, it says that you have been set free not to indulge the flesh, make excuses to not read the word, be selfish, live in anger. And there's a list in Galatians 5 talking about the acts of the flesh, right? But not to indulge in those things, but to serve one another in love, to walk in the Spirit. So you, right now, me and you, we have no excuse. No excuse, because it is the power of the Holy Spirit that is drawing us to the Word of God. But it is the flesh inside of us that is saying, no, you don't have time. Two, you're not really going to understand. It's just a waste of time. Three, you know, just the excuses go on and on and on and on and on. But if me and you, if we call ourselves Christian, this is our lifeline here. This is our lifeline. And again, it's all encompassing. It's all encompassing. It's not just the Word of God without the Spirit of God. It's not just coming to church without being at home. It's not just being in the prayer closet without being in community. It's all of these things together. And my heart today is to encourage you to look at the entire whole. And this is why the grace of God is so important for us, because He empowers us to do the right thing. And that's what we see in verse 10. I seek you with all my heart, but Lord, you keep me. I pursue you, but Father, you've been pursuing me for a very long time and you're drawing me in. I open the Word of God and I might not be able to understand, but Holy Spirit, you open my spiritual eyes and you help me understand. And that is the work of the Spirit. This is very much a partnership with God. If we show up, God's already there waiting. And that's the beautiful thing about being in relationship with Him. Verse 11, I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. And maybe for some of us struggling with particular sins in this room, it starts with the Word of God. It starts with the Word of God, the knowledge of God. And again, so much more than just information. Right? Not just knowing facts about the Bible, but opening the Bible with the heart of saying, God, I want to know your heart. I want to know you personally. God, would you reveal yourself to me? God, you made a way. This is why Jesus died on the cross. You made a way for me, God, so that I can get to know you. And guys, this is why, man, that song, the Lord, I'm amazed by you. How great, how wide is your love? It really hit me this morning, because I'm thinking of, God, we get to enter into the most holy place with you. What a privilege that we get to do that. Through your word, I get to commune with the Father. We're going to get to have communion with the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit in a little bit. We get to do that together. What a privilege it is. Understanding this, letting the Word be the foundation of our lives is what helps keeps us from sin. Verse 12, praise be to you, O Lord. Teach me your decrees. With my lips I recount all the laws that come from your mouth. I rejoice in following your statutes as one rejoices in great riches. Did you hear that? I rejoice in following your statutes as one rejoices in great riches. And I'm not sure if I've shared this example here before, but if I gave you, this is going to be grossly exaggerated. If I gave you $65 billion, right, you would probably be elated. But if I gave you this word today, I gave you a Bible, and not only just read it, but to follow the statutes of God, honestly, which one would we be more happy about? If I said to you, hey, listen, $65 billion, or the Word of God, not only just read it, but follow it, live by it, would there even be any comparison of joy between the two? But here, the author is saying that I rejoice in following your Word. Not just reading your word, not just listening to your word, but actually living your word as one rejoices with great riches, with $65 billion. Some of us would work out a way to get both. Some of us would, right? But as one rejoices with great riches, that is such a huge statement. And believe me, as I was reading through this, I was convicted. I'm like, God, am I joyful about following your word? Because sometimes it's like, oh, God, I got to do the right thing. I got to honor you. And it's just like, God, if only, man, I guess I'll do it. But here we see somebody who rejoices in following the word of God. And I'm going to make the argument here that we will not see the effects of the Word of God, the closeness of God, the power of the Holy Spirit, if we are merely listening to the Word of God and not following the Word of God. So maybe if you're in this place today and you're asking yourself, oh, they always talk about the power of the Holy Spirit. Oh, everybody's always raising their hands and weeping. Oh, everybody's shaking. Everybody's doing this, but I don't feel anything. I invite you to search your heart concerning the Word of God and how passionate you are about living and following the Word of God. Don't get me wrong, there are people who fake that other stuff too, right? But if you want to truly experience the power of God, it's the spiritual disciplines of living in the Word of God and living out the Word of God. I meditate on your precepts and consider your ways. I delight in your decrees. I will not neglect your word. Here we have these four action words: meditate, consider, delight, and I will not neglect. These are all intentional acts. And again, I will stress to you, you cannot just come to church and expect your life to just change, right? But instead, this is very much a relationship. I don't just go home to my wife and be like, I'm your husband, so you figure it out. I already did my job. I'm married to you, right? I don't just go home and not do my part as a husband. And I don't just go home with God and not do my part in my relationship with Him. Again, I am not preaching works. I'm not preaching that works saves us. But what I am preaching is that Jesus saved us, so now we are free to do the good things that He commands us to do. Because without Jesus, Without believing in Jesus, without the salvation of Jesus, you wouldn't have the Holy Spirit. And without the Holy Spirit, you don't have the power to follow the precepts and the statutes of the Word of God. You wouldn't even be able to do it on your own. You wouldn't be able to. But because of the Holy Spirit, we have been set free to do the works of God. And that is our part in it, that we accept, Jesus, you died for my sins and I am saved. Now I am on a mission to do your work and to fulfill your word that you have spoken, God. And that is our job as Christians, to walk in the purpose that God has given us. But how can we know our purpose if we don't know our word, right? How can our purpose be real to us if it's just secondhand knowledge? Again, the word of God. And how, man, let me ask this. How can we know that the word of God is true? We talk about freedom. We talk about the power of the Holy Spirit. We talk about the love of God. But us ourselves do not experience it because we're not living it out. The only way to experience these kinds of things as a Christian person is to live the Word of God. That's just what it is. There are no shortcuts. There are no shortcuts. If you want to be in the Olympics, you have to do Olympic level training. If you want to run a 4-minute mile, then you better run fast in training. If you hate running, you have no business. Are you a runner? If you hate running, are you a runner, right? If you hate running and you don't run, are you a runner? What Jesus did for us was we were without legs. Jesus died on the cross, made us new creation, gave us two very strong legs. What's his name? Usain Bolt. Gave us his legs to run. And we can run this race now. We can run this race. They gave us Jeremiah Bridgewater's legs. We can run this race now. We can run this race. In case you didn't know, Justin Bridgewater. Sorry, Justin. Jeremiah's still very fast, though. I've seen him on the basketball court. Justin's very fast. Justin is state known. Anyway, Justin, what was your fastest mile? What I'm talking about, 430 something, and he's being honest. He knows that last number. He knows. He's just being humble. He knows. It's probably 432, right? Anyway, we have been equipped by the power of the Holy Spirit to run this race, and some of us are choosing to sit down on a wheelchair and skate across. So I just challenge you, and believe me, I'm not sitting up here like, oh, you guys got to get your stuff together. I'm reading through this stuff. I'm like, Lord, help me. Help my heart. All right. Let's jump to verse 33. And this is just to reinforce what we've been talking about. Teach me, O Lord, to follow your decrees. Again, a dependency on God. Teach me, O Lord, to follow your decrees. Then I will keep them to the end. Give me understanding. Teach me. Give me understanding, and I will keep your law and obey it with all my heart. It is the understanding of the Holy Spirit that God gives us that we ask for. He's asking it for it here. He said, teach me, God. Give me understanding, God. And then look at this next verse. Direct me in your path, in the path of your commandments, for there I find delight. I find delight in your commandments. Our flesh hates the commandments of God. But he's saying here, I find delight in the things that you are telling me to do. And if we're honest here, not all of us are at that place of finding delight in the commandments of God. But what do we say here? He says, direct me in your path. Turn my heart towards your statutes and not towards selfish gain. Turn my eyes from worthless things. Preserve my life according to your word. Fulfill your promise to your servant so that you may be feared. Take away the disgrace I dread, for your laws are good. How I long for your precepts. Preserve my life in your righteousness. Here we have, teach me, God. Give me, God. Direct me, God. Turn my heart, God. Turn my eyes, God. Preserve my life, God. Fulfill your promise, God. Take away, God, and preserve. We have all these actions that are attributed, all these verbs that are attributed to God. So as you are in pursuit of Jesus in the Word of God, be on your knees before Him and say, God, teach me. God, give me understanding. God, direct me. God, turn my heart. Turn my eyes. Persevere my life. Fulfill your promise. Take away the disgrace. Preserve my life. All these things are in your hands, God. I'm just here, ready and available with your Bible open because I want to hear from you. And anything and everything that I learn, that I get from this, you will put into action, Holy Spirit. It is your work in my life, and I am submitted to you. This is the good news of God. I want to look at Matthew right now. Because all of these things, Matthew chapter 5, verse 17 or 18, all of these things concerning the law, concerning God's statutes, all of these things, Jesus fulfilled the law. And I'll just show it to you what he says. He says, do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish them, but to fulfill them. Jesus did not come to erase the 614 laws that are in the Old Testament. Instead, he came to fulfill them so that the burden of living that out was not placed upon us. There was no way in our strength without God that we would have been able to maintain a relationship with God. There would have been no way. But Jesus, on the cross, fulfilled the law, took the punishment of us not being able to fulfill the law, fulfilled the law so that we wouldn't have to. I tell you the truth, until heaven and earth disappear, not the smallest letter, not the least stroke of a pen, will by any means disappear from the law until everything is accomplished. So the law of God still stands true. The word of God still stands true. And Jesus came to fulfill this law. So in our pursuit of Jesus, we no longer worry about, sprinkling blood on the various instruments in the most holy place, which we're about to read. We're about to read a lot right now. We're no longer doing these kinds of things, etc. The beautiful thing is that if we would just believe in what Jesus has done in the cross, we have access to the most holy place with God. So let's just look at that holy place and what they did in Hebrews chapter 9. Are you ready? So I need you guys to pay attention because this is a mouthful. And I just want you, I want us to read it together, okay? This is what was accomplished in the most holy place before Jesus. This is what we would have had to do, and not us, a chosen person to go before God. A chosen person. Now, the first covenant had regulations for worship and also an earthly sanctuary. A tabernacle was set up in its first room where the lampstand, the table, and the consecrated bread, this was called the holy place. Behind the second curtain was a room called the most holy place, which had the golden altar of incense and the gold-covered ark of the covenant. This ark contained the gold jar of manna, Aaron's staff that had budded, and the stone tablets of the covenant. Above the ark were the cherubim of the glory, overshadowing the atonement cover. But we cannot discuss these things in detail now. Believe me, it's a lot of detail. It's a lot of detail. But basically, we just got a glimpse of what it looks like in the most holy place. Verse 6, when everything had been arranged like this, the priests entered regularly into the outer room to carry on their ministry. But only the high priest
entered the inner room that only once a year and never without blood, which he offered for himself and for the sins of the people, and for the sins the people had committed in ignorance. The Holy Spirit was showing by this that the way into the most holy place had not been disclosed. The tabernacle was still standing. This is an illustration for the present time, indicating that the gifts and sacrifices being offered were not able to clear the conscience of the worshiper. They are only a matter of food and drink and various ceremonial washings, external regulations applying until the time of a new order. So this is what God had in place until Jesus was to come. Again, we saw this picture of the most holy place. Only one person could come in to do whatever he had to do to forgive his sins and the sins of the people. But then we continue. When Christ came as the high priest, remember the high priest was the one that went into the most holy place. When Christ came as high priest of good things that are already here, he went through the greater and more perfect tabernacle that is not man-made. That is to say, not a part of this creation. He did not enter by means of the blood of goats and calves, but he entered the most holy place once for all by his own blood, having obtained eternal redemption. The blood of goats and bulls and the ashes of a heifer sprinkled on those who are ceremonially unclean sanctify them so that they are outwardly clean. How much more, then, will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself unblemished to God, cleanse our consciences from acts that lead to death so that we may serve the living God? So here we have Jesus acting as the high priest, going not into the most holy place here on earth, but going into the most holy place that no one has access to. Only the perfect being, only God himself, going into that holy place on our behalf so that we can experience the holy place that Jesus experienced here on earth. This is what Jesus did on the cross. His blood is sufficient to clear your conscience, my conscience. His blood is sufficient to give you peace, to give you hope, to give you freedom. His blood is sufficient to save your soul and set you free from the enemy. His blood is sufficient to make you a new creation with new desires, to deny your flesh. His blood is sufficient for us and for all in this world and in this nation. And let me tell you something. This isn't misinformation. This is the truth that we need to spread to everybody else. This is the truth that our hearts need to submit to. This is the truth that our minds need to meditate on. Not what the news is saying, not what Facebook is saying, not all this other negative stuff. This is the truth that we need to root our hearts in. Because when the bad news comes, guess what? I'm covered by the blood. When another virus comes, guess what? I'm covered by the blood. When somebody else wins the election, guess what? I'm covered by the blood. This is, listen, everything in the world, and that's not a political statement, please don't get me wrong, I do not represent the things of Acts of, I'm not trying to get into all that stuff. But this is what I'm trying to say. This is what I'm trying to say. I had to put that disclaimer there, we're online. All right? This is what I'm trying to say. This is what I'm trying to say. The blood of Jesus covers all things. The blood of Jesus covers all things. But friends, you're not going to experience the power of the blood if you're not in your word. You're not. I'm going to skip ahead and I'm going to go to Hebrews chapter 10. And this is the promise for us. Oh, whoops. This is the promise for us here. Sorry. I took out my thing. All right, Hebrews chapter 10, verse 19. Therefore, brothers, since we, talking about us, not talking about the high priest, talking about us, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way opened for us through the curtain that is his body, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart and full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience, and having our bodies washed with pure water. And let us consider how we spur one another on toward love and good deeds. Let us not give up meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but let us encourage one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. Friends, let us draw near to God, since we have access to the most holy place. Every time we open our arms or bow our hearts or bow our heads before God, we enter into the holy place with God. There are no hoops to jump through. There are no clothes to wear. There's no ritual that we need. It's just believing in Jesus, and you have access to the most holy, and guys, the same holy place that Jesus is in. The Bible tells us that we are seated with Christ. The Bible tells us that we are hidden in Christ, who is seated at the right hand of God. This is who you are. The first song we sang today, I know who you say I am. Well, God's telling you this. That you have access to the most holy place. So when you feel weak, when you feel discouraged, when you feel lost, when you are sick, when you are angry, when lust is overtaking your mind, when worry is overtaking your mind, when depression comes against you, when these things come against you, the things of the flesh and the things of the enemy come against you, you have access to the most holy place. And even holier place than the physical place that was here on earth. Because we have we are now the temple that God dwells in. Let's stand up together as we prepare our hearts for communion.
The blood of Jesus. Oh, the blood of Jesus. Oh, the blood of Jesus. It washes white as snow. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for the access that your blood gives us into your presence today. I'm going to ask our ushers to move through the crowd. You just stand right where you are. They're going to come right in front of you. These will be on a tray. Just touch the one that you choose. We're going to prepare our hearts to receive together. You that are at home, I hope you've gotten some juice, some cracker, a piece of bread, something, and you're preparing your hearts to receive the Lord's body and his blood together with us. But let's just allow the Holy Spirit right here, Pastor Jamil, to sing something. We'll allow the Holy Spirit to help us prepare our hearts. But you know what? When you receive, Jesus said, you receive life. You receive life. Unless you receive this, you can't have his life in you. Now, those are his words in the Gospels. And we're about to receive healing that the bread represents, and we're about to receive the life, the cleansing, and the washing that his blood represents. As soon as everybody has received, please just hold it when you receive it. If you're in this room, I will instruct you as to how to use it. Some of you have never used one like this before. So I'm going to give everyone the same instruction. We'll do it together as to how to use this sealed communion that has the wafer and the juice.
What can wash away my sin? Thank you.
brokenness through the cross, we can be healed today. Our brokenness can be healed because you were broken, Lord Jesus. You bore in your body the pain, the guilt, the sin, the shame, the sorrow, the despair, the hopelessness, so that your broken body means our bodies can be whole, our health can be whole, we can be kept and protected and covered. So I thank you for the power that the body, this bread represents today, that it brings healing right now for somebody. As we receive the bread today, please take the bread. Now if you'll take that little towel, can drop your cups off. They'll be out there to receive.